Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Today, we're going to break down some of the injuries that have happened late in the postseason, specifically Kyrie Irving and Kawhi Leonard. And we're also going to break down CP3 safety and health protocol with the COVID-19 virus and everything. But I want to start off with Kawhi Leonard's news. Obviously, you know, he suffered from a right knee sprain late in game 4 of the semifinals against the Utah Jazz. Obviously, you know, Kawhi Leonard, he's somebody who's been derailed with injuries his entire career. You know, he's got a history of a lot of knee injuries. And, you know, this isn't a good sign for the Los Angeles Clippers. I mean, they're coming off of a big series win against the Dallas Mavericks. They just won back-to-back games against the Utah Jazz. And ultimately, they look like they're in good position to, you know, have a legitimate shot of competing not only for a Western Conference championship, but an NBA Finals championship overall. Kawhi Leonard, he's leading the postseason in PER. He's second in points per game, second in rebounds per game, and he's third in field goal percentage. And with all that being said, you really don't want to lose a key valuable player like Kawhi Leonard at a pivotal time like this. We know the Utah Jazz are a legitimate team in the Western Conference. And then on top of that, if you end up beating them in this series, you're going to have to face against a Phoenix Suns roster that looks like the most complete and the most disciplined team in the postseason. So, I mean, with all that being said, hopefully Kawhi Leonard can, you know, we can get some more updates on this entire injury and everything. They haven't really given us a time frame as to when he's going to come back from this injury and, you know, all that stuff. But, I mean, besides that, Greg, what are your overall opinions on this entire injury and how can this affect the Clippers in a negative way?
Yeah, I think this injury is crazy just because, I mean, the knee, anything with the knee is going to be tough. Like, if it's sprained, it might be 1 to 2 weeks, maybe 2 to 3 weeks. It could be longer than that. If it's a torn ligament, like an ACL, MCL, or LCL, that's going to be out for the year. So we just really don't know. And I think what the Clippers need to do is just Paul George, first of all, needs to step up. He had a great game last night, and he just needs to carry off of that momentum. Any game that he's played very good in, the next game he always plays bad in. So I'm challenging him to step up and rally these guys around him and carry this team past the Jazz and get Kawhi that valuable rest that he needs so they'd be ready for the Suns. But I'm looking for Markieff Morris to step up. I'm looking for Reggie Jackson to continue to step up and help Paul George. And I'm seeing out of Terrence Mann and what he's bringing and the energy he's bringing off the bench for that small ball lineup. And if they continue to do that, I think they can get past the Jazz and figure out how they're going to attack this Kawhi situation. But it really starts with Paul George. I think he has the ability to do this. I feel like if he gets to his right spots, gets downhill, be aggressive from the start, and just follow the game plan, I think they will get over the Jazz and get ready for the Suns.
Right, and obviously, you know, the Clippers, they haven't played all that well without Kawhi Leonard this year.
Yeah.
I mean, they're 11-9 without him. Offensively, their numbers dip to a certain degree. I mean, offensive efficiency is down to 110.1, net efficiency down to 0.7, field goal percentage drops to 47% from the field, and your three-point percentage goes from 42% to a slight dip in 39%. So, I mean, obviously, you know, Kawhi Leonard is one of the most pivotal players on this team, and, you know, he really sets the tone for them on both sides of the basketball. He was an all-NBA caliber player this year alongside Paul George, but I do kind of feel like from a certain aspect that this kind of is a blessing in disguise. Guys like Terrence Mann are going to be able to get more minutes and more experience in the postseason, and ultimately you're going to be able to find roles for guys to be able to step up on both ends of the basketball. And ultimately, if Kawhi Leonard returns for the next upcoming series, these guys are going to have come into that series with a ton of confidence and a ton of momentum and all that.
Exactly.
But moving over to our next topic, I want to discuss the Chris Paul situation. I mean, obviously, you know, he tested positive for the virus and everything. We have no idea what the time frame is for how long he'll be out of. Typically, when you get marked for having the virus, guys miss 10 to 14 days. But I did find out yesterday that if he's able to get 2 negative tests within, I believe, either 24 to 48 hours and then go through some other protocols, he's got a good shot of suiting up for game 1 on time on Tuesday if a game 7 is forced by the Utah Jazz. But Greg, I mean, what are your thoughts on this entire CP3 situation, and how is this going to affect the Phoenix Suns overall?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to affect them for sure. You're losing a vocal leader. You're losing a leader in general, a guy who puts everybody in the right spot and who's great in the pick and roll. They have had a lot of success out of the high pick and roll with him and Ayton, the way Ayton's been cutting, the way Chris Paul's been snaking through that pick and roll and hitting that mid-range shot. But you know what? To be honest, Devin Booker's been stepping up, and I feel like if he's averaging 27 in the playoffs, I feel like if they run a high pick and roll with him and he finds open guys like Cam Johnson, who's been knocking down shots, or Mikal Bridges, who's been knocking down shots, and Jay Crowder, who's been knocking down shots, I feel like they'll be fine. It just, I know I'm challenging Devin Booker just like I'm challenging Paul George. Can he step up in the series to help them in the Western Conference Finals? But it will hinder them with not having Chris Paul in the game. But I feel like Monte Williams has got these guys prepared and put them in the right positions to be successful. But and I also like Cameron Payne. I think what he's done coming off the bench and being a spark, knocking down shots, creating good energy, being that leader on the defensive end too. I mean, they're all fundamental sound on, and they all play as unison, and they all play in a unit. So I really like the makeup on this team and how they all rally together. But it really starts with Devin Booker and how he will come out and fill that void, that leadership void, like Chris Paul does.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if he can hold the fort down until Chris Paul comes back, averaging about like 35 plus,
yeah,
I think the Phoenix Suns will be in good shape. I mean, Chris Paul, it's really a low blow because, you know, he's coming off of a very good series for him individually. I mean, against the Denver Nuggets, he averaged 25-10 off 67% from the field. Cameron Payne's definitely going to have to step up big and, you know, play a lot more minutes. He's going to go from probably 15 minutes to 29 to 30 minutes on a nightly basis. And, you know, this is obviously going to be a big blow to DeAndre Ayton offensively. Chris Paul is somebody that, you know, has really helped benefit his game overall. Yeah. Finding him when he's rim running to the basket, being able to, you know, read mismatches and, you know, enter the ball down in the post or even in the high post for him at certain aspects at the time. And being able to just run this offense to a very efficient way. I mean, like you stated, Devin Booker, I feel more than confident that, you know, this is one of the superstars that I think can really help propel this team to wins, especially with his second co-star out. But, you know, besides all of that, I do feel like Phoenix would definitely benefit from having Chris Paul, especially whenever he comes back. I do think, regardless of them playing the Utah Jazz or the Los Angeles Clippers, Chris Paul is smart enough to, you know, be able to dictate what he can get out of these respected defenses. When it comes to the Utah Jazz, I think he would kill Rudy Gobert in pick and roll scenarios.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, obviously he's a defensive player of the year, but he's not the perimeter defender that, you know, a guy like Ben Simmons or a Royce O'Neal is going to be defensively. So, I mean, with all that being said, I still feel like Phoenix has the best opportunity to make it out of the West.
Yeah.
And they are my favorite to make it out of the West overall. But, I mean, do you have any final thoughts on this entire situation before we move on?
No, I don't. Let's move on to the Kyrie Irving situation.
All right, and yeah, and speaking of Kyrie Irving, obviously, you know, he suffered that ankle injury. He rolled his ankle outwards and everything. You know, it, from my standpoint, it looked like it was a low inversion ankle sprain.
Yeah.
That's a lot. It's a lot better to hear that rather than it being a high ankle sprain, because high ankle sprains typically leave you out for a longer period of time than a low ankle sprain, and they're a lot more severe. But obviously, he's not going to return for the rest of the series and everything. Hopefully, he'll be able to make it back in time and not miss too much time in the following series. There hasn't been a time frame for when he'll return and everything, and we haven't got too many updates on his entire situation. All we know is that, like, whenever he was trying to get operated on after game 4 or game 5, whichever game it was, he was in extreme pain and he didn't want anybody messing with his ankle. But I mean, Greg, what are your thoughts on this entire situation? How is this going to affect the Nets?
This is tough news for the Nets, is because first of all, you lose another ball handler, lose another shot creator for KD, and that kind of hurt them in the game that KD went off either two nights ago or yesterday. And it really hurt them. I think that it will hurt them. I think with the liability that Harden's coming back off an injury and doesn't have the same movement that we're usually seeing him do. He did not go to the paint yesterday a lot. He did not He did not look for a shot that much. He did shoot the ball, but it wasn't efficient at all. He was kind of like a decoy out there. So not having Kyrie Irving out there is definitely going to hurt them on the offensive end, and it's gonna make KD have to do more. And it's gonna challenge the other players like Joe Harris, Bruce Brown, Landry Shamet, Jeff Green, Blake Griffin. All those guys, they're gonna have to figure out how to knock down shots and just be effective in the offense. And KD has to set them up. He has to be a playmaker. He has to figure out how to get everybody involved, but also getting himself involved and getting him in the rhythm. So it's gonna be tough, and we're gonna see if they can advance and he can carry him to the next series. But if Harden is not healthy, it's gonna be tough for them. But if Harden gets that mobility back and gets somewhat healthy and get his mobility back, where he can be that secondary playmaker, secondary ball handler and scorer for them, then I feel like the Nets will be fine going into the Eastern Conference Finals.
Yeah, and I mean, despite James Harden's putrid field goal percentage last game, he did contribute to a lot of the Brooklyn Nets' points, especially in the second half. His presence alone does a lot for that offense. I mean, if you swap out James Harden for Mike James, chances are the result of that game tend to be a lot different. And this probably is a closeout game for the Milwaukee Bucks. But I mean, obviously, you know, Kevin Durant, he's going to have another historic night in order to, you know, close out this series, especially with a hobbled James Harden. But I do want to point out that I feel like the Brooklyn Nets don't trust Kevin Durant to close out a game on the road by himself, let alone the series without, you know, one of his co-stars alongside him. And, you know, that just kind of tells you a little bit about how this organization feels about him individually. I'm not saying that they don't trust him, but obviously, you know, they don't have all that much confidence in in Kevin Durant playing by himself and all that. But I mean, aside from that, I do feel like Kyrie Irving's injury is a big blow to them. He's somebody that has bailed them out of a lot of bad situations offensively. He's one of those guys that they can give the ball to at the end of the shot clock and get him a basket outside of Kevin Durant and James Harden, obviously. But hopefully he can continue to rehab that ankle, make sure that he's going to be ready for this next upcoming series if they advance, and ultimately just be able to play his brand of basketball.
Exactly. Yeah, I do not want them to rush him back, kind of like what they did with Harden. I want at least him to be at least 80-90% going forward for the rest of the playoffs.
Yep, but I think that wraps it up for this episode, guys. Thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. Make sure to follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook as well. And if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But also, if you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and turn on post notifications. But aside that, it's your boy, Nicey Chungabini. I'm here with my co-host, Greg King, and we out.
We out.